You are listening to The Hour of the Time. I'm Pete Lesprince.
And I'm Tim. Good evening, folks. We're going to have a good show for you tonight. Have pen and paper by your side. I know you've heard Bill say that many times. We have some good information for you and some good exchange information. So bear with us, and here we go with some good music. Good evening, folks. Bill's away tonight. He's wrapping a lot of Christmas presents. He's pretty involved in it tonight. So we're going to be doing a show, and I want to wish everybody a Merry Christmas and Happy New Year from myself and the staff here and Surplus and stuff. I want to thank everybody. Things that we're going to be talking about tonight will be of most interest on camping clothing. Alice Pack and all. But first of all, I want you to write this down. That remember, Behold the Pale Horse is on a Christmas special at $18.50 for non-members. Members of the CAGI Intelligence Service is $15.50. And it'll be on sale until midnight Friday. So your order must be postmarked midnight Friday, December 23rd, 1994. Also, you can send that to Annie, make your checks out to Annie, A-N-N-I-E, to the Intelligence Service. Post Office Box 1420, Sholo, Arizona, 85901. That's Intelligence Service, Post Office Box 1420, Sholo, Arizona, 85901. And also, folks, April 15th is available, and it's $43 postpaid. Again, make your checks out to Annie, and she'll get this off to you. Annie also has compiled and given me a new tape list that she has available of all the tapes from January 3rd of 1994 to present that she's put together. And if you want a copy of the new tape list, send her a self-addressed envelope, number 10 size, self-addressed and stamped, and she'll send you back a tape list in the return mail. And the Luxor tape is available, which is a videotape, and treason documents are also available. So there's many good things that you can get at the present from Bill and Annie. One thing I wanted to talk about tonight, folks, last time I was on, we were talking about equipment and things you should carry in your vehicle, get your vehicle repaired, and keep it in good shape. You never know when you're going to need it when you're out camping. And I've had people write and call me and tell me how much they appreciated some of the information that they've gotten from that. So if you're out camping, I wanted to share this with you on hiking equipment, things that you should be carrying in your pack. And you should have, first of all, at least two changes of underwear, shorts, and t-shirts, two pairs of extra socks, one extra regular shirt, one extra pair of pants. Also in your pack, you should carry a pair of boots, lightweight, or even gym shoes. Even though I don't much care for the gym shoes myself, if something should happen to your regular hiking boots, a heel, or it should split, or have any type of problem, getting them soaking wet, and they must be dried out, you can change your socks and carry an extra pair of boots with you. You can put those on until you can get your main hiking boots repaired or dried out. That is important. Depending on the season of the year when I'm out camping, I'll always carry a pre-season duffel bag with extra clothes for the coming season. For instance, in the late fall, or early fall rather, when some of your like muzzleloader or archery seasons come out for deer hunting or elk or such things, I'll carry my winter clothing in an extra duffel bag, because in the mountains and out west here, you never know when the weather's going to change. So you want to carry some suitable clothes with, rather than just your lightweights, in case you run into cold weather, freezing rain, or even snow. So if you're out turkey hunting or something like that in the springtime, I'll have my cold weather clothing with me. And if it does get real warm, I'll have a change of lighter weight clothing. So those things will help you there. Also, some of us like to get out and do some rappelling. Rappelling is going off to side of the mountains and things of this nature. You've probably seen that on TV. There's several books, and there's a lot of different clubs and areas all over the country that do this kind of work. You can go to some of your local camping and hunting stores, and they could give you some advice as to where there's a rappelling club and what books are available and what types of equipment. You just never know when you're out hiking when you might need to use and learn some of that type of gear, and how to tie knots and lower things down. And if you're out hunting, if you're up high and have to lower your animal down that you were just out hunting and got, it was very helpful to know some of these things. Also in your backpack when you're out camping, I'll give you a list of some things that you might want to carry in your backpack. And you want to try and carry some type of a stove, a little trioxin stove or a little butane stove. Have extra fuel for it. Have an extra package of fire starting sticks. Carry a little bag of, or a bottle rather, of water tabs. A roll of toilet paper, a washcloth, and a towel. A flashlight with fresh batteries in it. On your batteries, when you put them in your flashlight, you want to put a piece of masking tape around them and write the date that you put the batteries in your flashlight. So that way you'll always know that you put fresh batteries in it and when you did put them in there. And if you think they're too old, put fresh ones in there. You want to carry some type of a pocket utility knife, a small axe with a cover, a little survival saw. There's various types. They fold out, and then there's a ring type with little blades on it. A mirror you want to use for signaling in case you get in trouble or you get lost out there. You can use the signaling mirror. You want to carry a mess kit that you can cook some food in. You want to carry some type of shovel, also called an entrenching tool, to help build your fire area and to cover your fire after you get through with your fire and want to cover it. Emergency blanket. You want to carry some type of tie wire with you. And that tie wire, if you want to build a makeshift shelter, if you're out hiking and it's sunny and too much sun and you want to take a break and get out of the sun, you can build yourself a little lean-to type shelter and use the wire to help tie it together. Or in the wintertime, there's a lot of people, believe me, that like to go out backpacking in the wintertime and set up little camps and such things as this. And skiers and people that go out snowshoeing and all winter sports like that out here are pretty prevalent. You want to use a roll of black vinyl electric tape, container of waterproof matches, and carry a knife, fork, and spoon set with you, a compass with instructions, carry a whetstone to sharpen your hunting knife and pocket knife, and you want to carry a package of sewing needles and thread with you in case you have to repair a shelter half you might have, or you tear your pants or jacket or whatever, you can repair it. Also a package of safety pins and some type of thread. I carry a poncho liner instead of a blanket. It's a little bit lighter and serves the same purpose. So those are some of the things that you might want to think about. This is just a guideline, folks, to make you think of things that you can add to whatever you want to carry with you. But don't carry things you don't need, making a junk pack out of what you're going to be carrying. Think ahead weather-wise, what it's going to be like. Get the equipment that you need. Right now, there's a good value in some of the surplus stores on snowshoes. The military has released some magnesium-type snowshoes compared to the wood and leather, or rawhide, I should say. And then they make the wood and neoprene, which are good. I've used those for several years. And I'm waiting for some snow to come here in Arizona so we can go out and try the magnesium type snowshoes. They look real durable, and we got several of those in, so we're going to give them a try this winter. So you might want to think of some of these things. And if there's any information, we'll be passing it on later on in the show. I'll give you a number. We can call in and pass out information again. And again, don't forget some of Bill's things that he's going to have on sale. So let's see here. Yes, don't forget you want to get boots and galoshes to carry with you for bad weather also. Late fall rains, snows, spring rains and such. So anyhow, you want to carry some of those things with you. And some people can wear wool, some can't. And myself, I can't. Don't forget, and carry a radio with you. A lot of times if you're in a situation, if you do get lost or have problems out in the field when you're out camping or whatever, a radio is real comforting to have with you to listen to music or the news or the hour of the time in the evening on the shortwave side of your radio that you have. Don't forget to keep a small solar-type battery charger with you for AA's. I would suggest getting a small-type radio, combination shortwave AM/FM. And they usually take anywhere from 2 to 4 AA batteries. And with the solar charger, you'll be able to charge your batteries during the day and listen to music and shortwave at night. So it's just little ideas like that that we just want to pass along to you folks. And we're going to be opening up the phones for call-ins at 602-337-2524. Give us a call if you have any information you want to trade with us. It's only information tonight, folks. I don't want to have any calls pertaining to nothing else except hiking and camping gear and trading information. And also remember, folks, Christmas time, families are going to be getting together. And any of those hidden recipes that you got hidden away out there, ladies, that you want to trade with others, whether it's making jerky or cakes or breads or biscuits or anything like that, let's trade them around, or how to do some canning would be a great value to everybody to learn this. So the phone number, folks, is 602-337-2524. And we'll be taking calls. Okay, no caller yet. Don't forget, get yourself a good durable knife if you're out hiking. A good quality knife. Make sure it's got a good handle on it and that the blade goes all the way through the hilt. And there's not much brass on it, because brass does bend. Get you a good quality steel hatchet. You never know when you're going to have to cut a little bit of wood.
Good evening, you're on the air.
Hello, I'd like to know, you were talking about jerky. Can you tell me what you can do to preserve jerky?
To preserve jerky?
Yes, sir.
Okay, well, the best thing to do is when you have your, when you're making jerky, is make sure all the fat is off of it.
Yes, sir.
And then there's different recipes available for the different mixture that you want to marinate your meat in. Make sure it's pretty well dried, whether you use an oven, a convection type oven, or what have you. And then when you go to put it away, do not put it in a jar or a tin can or a anything like that, plastic, because it will create moisture and this will create it to spoil on you. Take yourself, without your wife finding out, an old pillow sack, because the pillow sack, being cotton, are porous and they breathe.
Oh.
And you put your jerky in there and then hang it up out in the garage or whatever. And I have some in my workshop that's been up there 2 years and it's real hard, but it's still good and it's not spoiled.
So you wouldn't recommend putting in one of these plastic bag vacuum machine type operations?
I've never tried a vacuum type operation. I've never had one to use or available to me, so I just use the old style, what they call a flour sack saving type. Does that answer your question?
I think so. Is there any type of ingredients that you soak it in to preserve it?
Yes, there's different recipes available. You can go to some of your camping or hunting stores, they have books on making jerky. You can go to the meat market. They have different types of jerky mix available that you can buy right off the counter.
Okay, well, I appreciate it.
You're quite welcome.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Well, there's a good one for anybody who has any short jerky recipes. I love jerky myself, whether it's elk or beef. Good evening, you're on the air.
Hi, good evening. I'd just like to share with you what our little group of folks is doing with respect to carrying trail food. We have switched to, instead of carrying these surplus type meals, we're taking and putting into these 1 liter containers, soda containers, things like rice and dry beans and things like that, and we're finding we can carry about 2 weeks' supply of food in our pack. over perhaps 3 or 4 days of the other type of meals. And I just thought I'd share that with the folks because it seems to be real effective.
Yes, it is. I've done that myself. We've been, you know, in your field pants or whatever. You can put a half pound in each pocket and around, and you can wind up carrying a lot of weight without a lot of strain on your body. Thank you very much. That was a good one. Ladies and gentlemen, there's a good tip also. So there's a lot of information out there. All we have to do is pass it around because we're just relying on each other to help each other. Good evening. You're on the air.
How you doing, Tim?
Hi.
Hey, got another Tim. This time the East Coast Tim talking to West Coast Tim. Okay, like a lot of times on these programs, you know, you have people talking saying, gee, this is fine, but the radishes, rutabagas, and cauliflower didn't come in, and the biggest expenditure is a weapon. Bolt guns run over 500. AKs are starting to disappear. FALs and stuff, they're like $1,700, $1,800. M16s and such are a problem, you know, and so on and so forth. Here's the info. Potomac Arms, which is a retail establishment, Christ, it sounds like I'm doing a commercial, division of InterArms, okay, is selling British surplus Lee Enfield rifles, 303 caliber, for $99.
Mm-hmm. That's a good value.
That's a real good value. You also got some American-made by Winchester military surplus 303 floating around, 160 grain, full-patch bullets. You also got some Czechoslovakian ammo out there that's pretty good. This stuff's running between $8 and $10 for 20 rounds. So to all those folks out there in the farms and the hinterlands just saying, gosh, how am I going to do this? At $99 and maybe $25 or so for shipping from your local dealer, that ain't a bad deal because you are not going to buy a .22 pistol for $125.
That's true. Thank you very much.
Okay, Tim. Bye-bye now.
Thank you. Another thing, ladies and gentlemen, keeping some .22s around for rabbit hunting and things of that nature, your old 20 or 12 gauge shotgun for pheasant and quail would be coming handy for duck hunting and things of that nature. Good evening, you're on the air. And I guess Dick Collar didn't want to wait. So there's just little things out there that can help. And it doesn't cost a great deal, a lot of money to get into. Single shot, shotguns and stuff when you're out camping helps out. So if we have any more callers that want to call in, it's 602-337-2524. Good evening, you're on the air.
Hi, Tim, Pete. Hi, this is Jim from Los Angeles.
Oh, good evening.
Jim, I was out there at the conference and the camp out this summer. And I just wanted to say you must have been a supply card in another life because you've got one of those well thought out, well organized and stocked surplus stores I've ever seen. I've been going to surplus stores a long time and I've never seen one so well done as yours.
Well, I thank you. All we do is try. I try and help everybody.
I've got a couple quick comments and then maybe a question for you.
Okay, go ahead.
I've had a LTE and a RUC all packed up and ABAG packed for some time out of habit. And I found that unless you practice mobilizing that stuff, taking it out to the field and using it, you won't really know what works and you won't be able to do it in a hurry if you really need to. And I think you maybe touched on it, Bill's maybe touched on it in the past, but it's a point that probably bears repeating. I've been looking for a tan desert type LTE, and I haven't found too much. And I wondered if you're familiar with what's out on the market, what's available, the availability of that stuff. I understand a lot of it is planned to be demilled in the future or just not released to the public. And before you answer that, let me just make one other comment. You had a great suggestion in the past about using a BAR belt for full-size magazines like FN-type magazines. And that's worked real well for me. I tried that, and it worked out real well. So I want to thank you for that. Answer the question.
Okay. If you will, why don't you give me a call tomorrow, and I can let you know what's available in the colors that you want. Every day I'm out checking to see what's available. Equipment is getting short. Yes, I do understand that they're trying to get rid of some of it and not auctioning it off and letting the big buyers come in. So we might have a problem. So just give me a call, and I'll be glad to help you with your needs at any time. Okay?
Yes, also, have you heard anything further about Feinstein's plan to make wearing or availability of camouflage uniforms or military-type uniforms unavailable, or this rumor about camo cans and camouflage nets and that sort of thing being outlawed by the government?
I have no confirmation on that as of yet, and like I say, I'm in contact with some people, bigger suppliers, and they've told me that they've heard about it, but there's no facts, so I cannot say for sure.
Okay. Thank you very much, Tim. I appreciate the job you and Peter are doing.
Thank you.
Bye.
Yes, if you have any questions pertaining to any of the equipment, you always can call me, folks, at area code 602-337-2975. If I'm not there, leave word on the machine. I know a lot of people don't want to talk into it. But just leave word and put the date and time that you called in, and I will call you back. Sometimes it might be a day or two, but I do try and return all my calls. Some people say, well, I've called you and nothing has ever happened. Well, when you talk into a machine, slow down, give exact numbers, and that way I can make it out and give you a return call. So, anyway, right now we're getting into cold weather, so you want to think about cold weather clothing. And also after the Christmas season, what comes up usually in January? The big white sale. And all your big stores have a sale on all winter clothing because the spring clothing is coming out. Well, think ahead. Think ahead. Go in and buy some of that clothing that's on sale. A lot of times you'll find tremendous values in kids' clothing or children's clothing. And clothing for yourself also. Stock up on gloves. They have some great buys on gloves that are thin slate lined and stuff, and gloves that might run anywhere from $9 to $15 a pair. You can buy them for $6.50 or $5 a pair, so you can afford to pick up two or three pair and stash them away for next winter. Remember, clothes do not spoil, and if you find out that some of your clothing is a little bit too small for your child or you've grown yourself, you always can swap with somebody else that thought ahead and started buying some of the clothing at white sales. I know all your big stores, Sears, Penney's, and what have you, Walmart, they all have these sales going on, and that's the time to start scarfing up. We're almost in the midway of the bad weather and winter, so they're going to reduce all these prices so you can gain on it. Don't forget to get sunblock. Sunblock works real well when you're out in the sun. The cream will help you not get windburn, plus it won't burn your skin. Don't forget sunglasses when you're out in the snow to help your eyes, because you can get snow blind and it does hurt. And don't forget to call in, folks, at 602-337-2524.
Don't believe the devil, I don't believe it, but the truth is never the same without the lies you made up. Don't believe in excess, just as we feel. Don't believe in riches, we can see where I live. I don't believe in fortune, don't believe in rage, but every time she has a fight, wild horse stays. Don't believe in death row, these roads can. Don't believe in the ooze, just went off in my hand. I believe in love. Thank you.
Yes, folks, we're always looking for the best value for the money. Whether we're out grocery shopping, camping supplies, fishing supplies, and what have you. But there's certain things that always retain value that you should be looking forward to, and that's precious metals, gold, silver. And these things will always maintain value no matter what the economy is, because they always have a market. You'll always be able to buy things with those. So Swiss America has a good program for people that are looking into the future, that want to set up portfolio or just buying a few at a time. You can call Swiss America at 1-800-289-2646. And they'll be glad to help you in any way they can set up what you want. If you want to set up a program and buy so much silver or gold or something, I'm sure they'll help you in any way they can. They've done it for me, and I can call down there, and they give me information all the time on silver. Myself, I just buy silver rounds from them, and I just put those away and give them out for birthday gifts or just presents here and there. And that piece of silver that I give out will always retain its value, no matter what the economic situation is. So try Swiss America, folks. They'll be glad to help you. And again, their number is 1-800-289-2646 or 1-800-BUY-COIN. So there's a lot of value out there. In various forms of precious metals. They have all the information. They keep up with it. That is their business. They are honest. They do what they say. I know that from firsthand experience. So I don't have to say I really don't know, but this time I do know. I've made friends with Gene Miller down there, and he's helped me out quite a bit, which I greatly appreciate. And I never understood that type of market before, and they really don't care how many questions you ask, as long as you ask questions and you learn from it, and eventually you can start putting some gold or silver away for the future, because we are going to need it. And so they can give you a great help at this time, folks, and they're good people. Give them a try, give them a call. Do it now at 1-800-289-2646.
Thank you.
back again, folks. The call-in number is 602-337-2524. And another thing I want to talk about, skis. A lot of you folks like to use skis out there. You can go to the sporting goods stores and you can find some good values in used skis, too, if you just want to try cross-country skiing.
Good evening. You're on the air.
Yes, I'm trying to radio down here. I've got some catalogs here that advertise boots called Mickey Mouse boots. Are they? Do you know what I mean?
Yes, those are the military extreme cold weather boots. Some have valves in them, and for you can pump up with air.
Are you of the opinion that they are all have the are as virtuous as the ads make them out to be?
Myself, I can't wear them.
Oh.
Your feet get too hot in them. They don't breathe.
Oh, I see. Oh.
And extreme cold. They were designed for Arctic weather mainly, and they work fine up there, where you have a lot of availability of changing socks and getting them dried out and stuff. But myself, they don't work. Some people, they like them. There's some good values out there in the Mickey Mouse boots. You can buy them in white rubber or black, with or without the air valve. And they're fine, but they're also heavy. And in some instances, they're clumsy. The newer type boots that are out by Danner or Hi-Tech and a few of the others make a good lightweight boot with Tensilate and Gore-Tex in them, where your feet do breathe and they're a lot lighter, and you can walk a lot further in them.
Okay, then, but they do have they are superbly have superb insulating qualities, though.
Yes, they do.
Okay, that's well what I want to know. Thank you.
All right, thank you for calling. The you want to look into boots in some of the bigger stores. They have a variety of different manufacturers. On boots, look for Thinsulate and Gore-Tex insulation and what degree they'll go down, and make sure that they're waterproof.
Good evening, you're on the air.
Tim, I've got two things. What's your recommendation on two-way communications? And we'll just answer that one. You know, like radios?
Okay. There's various types of communication out there. If you're hiking around a camp area, you can use a CB radio. If you're a ham operator, you can use 2-meter band radios. They're pretty good. Either one of those are excellent, you know.
Yeah.
Whether you're out hunting or hiking or whatever, to stay in contact with your camp in case something does happen, they are helpful.
One other question. Can you get snow blindness on an overcast day, and what do you do to prevent that?
Wear sunglasses.
Okay.
Anytime you're out in the snow, just like being in water, when you're out boating, the reflections are just as bad as the direct sunlight. So when I'm out in that type of weather, I always carry goggles with me, sunglasses. I've had snow blindness, and it does hurt, and it is painful. And it takes a while to recover from it.
Is there over-the-counter remedy you can keep for that, to put in your eyes?
What we just used was regular, Visine or any of those eye washes out there that really helped. And go into the shade so you're not looking out into the sun or getting reflections off the snow or water, if it's summertime water or whatever. And it does help.
Yeah, I like the way you do the show, Tim. Enjoy it.
Well, thank you. Good hearing from you again.
You bet. Bye.
Bye. Folks, the phone number is 602-337-2524. And Bill's away wrapping Christmas presents, and I hope he's having fun and don't get too much sticky fingers with all the stickers and the packings and everything else he's doing and bows and everything else. I hope he's having a good time tonight.
Good evening. You're on the air.
Good evening.
on the air now?
Yes, you are. You want to turn your radio off, please?
Okay. When I had a problem with snow blindness, I nearly had snow blindness a few years back there because I had forgotten my sunglasses, stupidly, at the base camp. But I found out a piece of Mylar from my emergency blanket when it was taped over my eyeglasses worked just as well at preventing the blinding glare of the sun.
Yes, you could use that. You can use clothing, thin part of cotton clothing, T-shirt, anything that'll cut down the glare and reflection, and you can still keep going, yes.
You mentioned about equipment for long term. A couple of hurricane glass and metal lanterns, the type they use for outdoors, would be very good.
Yes, those are the old kerosene type lanterns. Use kerosene or diesel fuel.
Or charcoal lighter fluid.
Yes, that does work too.
And you were mentioning about keeping a battery, keeping a radio powered by a small solar panel. Well, there's also the trick of using a bicycle generator with one of those DC to DC converters. That is, you can get one of those from Radio Shack or Walmart that converts down to 9, 6, and 3 volts. And you can actually run that off a bicycle generator to power your radio.
Yes, that's a good suggestion. What I suggested was using the solar battery charger that charges AA batteries.
Well, that's good, too. It's also good to invest in one of the larger panels there to get your 12-volt charge for your CB use.
You can. A lot of your handheld CBs will use anywhere from 6 to 8 of your AA batteries also.
Yes, well, it's nice to hear that your show is on the air, and it's more refreshing than the other shows.
Well, I thank you very kindly, sir.
May you keep on going.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye.
Okay, if you have any further calls, folks, we got about 10, 12 minutes, and it's 602-337-2524.
Good evening. You're on the air.
Hi, Jim. I have a little suggestion about firearms. I'm from Massachusetts up here, and I happen to be a firearms dealer, but they have available a couple of small little firearms for backpacking. One's the AR-7. Everything folds up and fits in the back. It's 22. It'll take 22 stingers, which is a potent little round. It'll take down just about anything out there. Also, with the Springfield Armory, I believe, makes one that's 410-22, the scout rifle, and it has a little plate in the back for I think, four 10-gauge shells, and I think probably about 20-22-round cartridges in the back.
Yeah, we also have the little snake charmer camp rifle, as it's called.
Right.
It's a 410. That AR-7, too, is also compact, and I believe they float if you're out fishing or whatever, and or just fall down in a creek or something that you're crossing. It will float, and the way the weapon is made and with the coating on it, all you have to do is just wipe it down. It won't rust on you either.
That's true. Also, the gentleman was talking about the AR-15s or whatever. There's a lot of brands of ARs, and all about the same. And I've done a pretty extensive test. I'm a full-auto dealer, so I have the license. But with the AR-15 or the M16 thermal magazines, they work tremendously well. Not the expandable ones from 30 to 45, the regular 30-round thermals, all types. The ones for the HK, I mean, those magazines are going for $75 to $100 right now, the steel mags. If you dent them, they don't work. The thermals are self-lubricating, and they're just great magazines, and you still get them for about $12 to $15 at some gun shows, and, they're great mags. You can run over them with a truck, and they still work.
Well, that's good. Thank you for the suggestion.
Sure.
Okay, folks, I have a little information on a little 22 and a 410 shotgun's always handy to have around your camp.
Good evening, you're on the air.
Well, I guess that caller didn't want to stay on the line and play games on the air as we brought him in.
Good evening, you're on the air.
Yes, hi, is this Tim?
Yes, go ahead.
Hi, how you doing?
Fine.
This is Tim over in California also. What I want to ask you is two questions. Is concerning scopes, like Burris and Leopold, I know they make really good rifle scopes and stuff. Is it best to get like a 3x12, maybe 50 millimeter optics on it? Or are you better off with like a 6x24 for farther reaching out long range?
Well, it depends on the individual, number one.
Okay.
What he's accustomed to, what type of rifle he's going to put it on.
It would be like a Winchester and 308.
Myself.
Model 70.
On my own hunting rifles. I have a 3-9 on those, and I find that's more than sufficient for most big game, elk, deer, whatever.
Okay.
And if you have a bigger caliber or whatever, you might have, depending on what you're, like I say, what you're getting used to.
Sure.
What you want to spend.
And then the other thing is, like a pack, like say a guy weighs about 200 pounds, what weight-wise, you know, you don't want to be bogged down with like a 100-pound pack. I mean, so should you like a pack between 50 and 75-pound pack? Because there's on your list, there's a lot of stuff, and all this stuff begins to add up along with your food and stuff. You want to be lightweight, but at the same time, you know, have most of your stuff on your list that you've talked about.
My pack weighs roughly 50 pounds.
Okay.
Give or take a few.
In that ballpark, you should try to have a pack so you could, like, make time and move.
This is correct. You want to get used to carrying your pack also, so you don't want to take all that weight at one time. So while you're not out camping or hiking or whatever, just start out with a lighter weight and start out at 10 or 15 pounds. Get used to that and then add 5 or 10 pounds, whatever you feel comfortable with.
Well, I have a Kelty one with expedition packs where it has all the extra compartments and pockets and stuff, and I can load that thing down to 80 pounds, but you can't move and make time.
I can show you how you can load an 85-pound pack, plus carry a weapon and everything else, and you're not going to move that fast, but you have to get in condition.
Yeah.
One thing.
What is the standard for, like, the military, the federal troops and stuff, a military use for standard weight on their alpha packs and all that stuff? Is it about 50 pounds?
I would say so.
Okay.
I would say so.
Thank you very much, and you have a very nice Christmas.
Well, thank you.
Over there in Arizona. Keep up your patriotic stand.
Well, thank you.
Thank you.
Don't forget, folks, get in condition. When you go out hiking or go out for walks around the block, around the house, and what have you, just try and stay in condition. You don't have to go out and do a lot of jogging or anything. Just get out and do some exercise. Stick with it. Every day doing walk around the block and then 2 blocks, 5 blocks, a mile, what have you, and stay with it, and you'll stay in shape. You'll keep good wind. If you do go out into the country or park, put a little knapsack on with 10 or 15 pounds and just get used to the weight. And you'd be surprised how much fun camping and hiking will be in the future. Good evening, you're on the air.
Yeah, I've got a question about winter camping. Can you recommend a good type of stove to use for a tent, like a Riley or something like that? What do you recommend?
There's naturally the military type little round pot belly. There's some on the market. There's the, as we call them out here in Arizona, the sheep herder stoves, depending on the size of your tent. A lot of people just put wood in them, and they forget to put sand in the bottom, and they also burn the bottoms out. Put a few inches of sand or dirt in the bottom, and it will help retain heat when your fire goes low, too. And also, in your tent, wherever you place your stove, if you have the cutout in a mountain-type tent or the old miner's type as they're referred to, or the military, there's usually a cutout in the roof so that you can set up your stove and put some type of a shield, lightweight aluminum or something like that, between your stove and the wall of your tent so you don't cause a fire. And because if you're out camping or hiking and you get a wind, you might get an updraft, and your stove will get real hot. Also, watch the type of wood you put in there. The more pitch that you have in the wood that you're using, in pine and pinon and such, the more heat you're going to create. So you have to be careful in regulating your heat in the stove so that you don't burn your tent down.
Okay.
Then you don't have a camp.
Two other questions I'd have. One is, you know, you can find most books about how to set up your camp and things like that. But in a survival situation, is there a way that you can set up a camp so it's not, easy locatable by someone else? Are there any books on the market about that?
Read the different survival books. Are you near a forest or camping area or whatever?
Yeah. I've got like Kephart's book, and he just tells a little bit in there about how to conceal your camp and stuff from other people. But I was wondering if there's any more books on it other than like Army survival manuals or something that would have some of that.
Well, they don't tell you how to conceal it. Just go out when you're out hiking, look at the situation, think about it,
okay,
of what you would do. Look at it and think about it, and you'll have your answer.
Okay. I got one point I thought I might pass on to everybody. I read about this once, that if you have eyeglasses and you lose them out in the wilderness, we've tried it ourselves where we've taken a piece of paper and punched a very small pinhole in it. And it seems like the small concentration of light allows you to see a lot better without the lens. For a short period of time, I'm blind in one eye almost, and I can almost read a book when we try that method. Have you ever heard of that before?
No, I have not.
It's just basically take a piece of cardboard or paper and cover your eye with it and punch a little pinhole. And of course, you want to do that before you put it over your eye, so where you can see through it, so the edges aren't too burred. And it's amazing the difference that you'll see through there. If you can't see without glasses and then you put this on, it'll help you see where you're going and stuff.
Well, that's a good helpful hint. I've never heard of that, but I'll certainly try that.
Yeah, if you wear glasses, try it. It does work. I've been able to read a book that I couldn't read before with a bad eye that way.
Well, myself, every time I get a new pair of eyeglasses, and a dear friend of mine who's in the eyeglass business, he's always hounding me, keep a spare set of glasses and everything, and I do, and I use the plastic lenses instead of glass. I wear glass, but my reserve glasses are made out of plastic. That way, if they're in a knapsack or whatever, and if you're throwing it around, they don't get broke.
Mm-hmm. Okay, well, thanks very much. Appreciate the show.
Okay, thank you, sir. Don't forget, ladies and gentlemen, to get the value on the Behold a Pale Horse at $18.50, and that's for non-members, and for members, it's $15.50. You must have your orders postmarked by midnight Friday, December 23rd, to the Intelligence Service, P.O. Box 1420, Sholo, Arizona, 85901. And also, goodbye April 15th is $43 postpaid. Make your checks out to Annie, A-N-N-I-E. Thank you, folks. I hope you have a good, safe holiday. Merry Christmas and Happy New Year's to everybody. And, Bill, I hope you're still wrapping packages. Good night, folks. You're trying to be right.